It's a little bit after 10, and it's really a joy to see everyone. Thanks for being with us, whether it's your first time or your, let's see, maybe 60th time on Zoom with us. I'm going to mute everyone. You're welcome to unmute when it's time to speak. That could be during like the prayer time. Kathy Jamison's going to share with us a little bit. And Kathy, if you could do that during the announcement time, that'd be great. If you're on Zoom currently, you're going to be able to see the worship, the flow of worship in the chat. But you could also go to the church's website, which is fpcberry.org, and you can find the worship bulletin there. It's sort of a click on the third graphic there on that page. So I'll remind folks that we're here on Zoom as a community. It looks like there are, 30 or so people joined with us so far. And then we're also on Facebook, and that's a live stream, which I mentioned just to make sure that if you choose to share something during the prayer time, that you know that it's more public than just this little group. The background that I'm using today, since it's Earth Care Sunday, is Spruce Peak from some line that's kind of right between Plainfield and Berrytown. So if you're wondering if I'm actually outdoors and not freezing, I'm not outdoors and not freezing, I'm indoors, but with a little background here. So it's really great to have everyone with us. As we do at the beginning of our services, I will share a 1 minute moment where we remember the first inhabitants of the lands on which we gather. And I'll invite us to hold this moment, remembering the first inhabitants, some of whom have continued to be in this area all along. Sylvia Mitten is serving as our worship leader this morning. So, Sylvia, thanks for what you'll share now.
You're welcome. And I welcome everybody that is joining us today for this service. It is a spring day. It's beautiful out there, a little cool, but it'll get there. But when I look at the pictures of the city pasture and the flowers and everything and Spruce Peak, it just makes me think how special our land really is. Planet Earth. There's so much beauty on this little planet. God is quite the artist, don't you think? He knew that the earth needed to be cared for, so he made us stewards of this planet to keep it healthy and beautiful. We all know that the government has passed many laws to try to cut down on trash, pollutants, overlogging, reduce carbon footprints, keep our water clean, reverse climate change, et cetera, the list goes on and on. The thing is, we all must do our part in one way or another to advance us along this path of cleaning up our planet. We all know, some of you have probably read that the articles in the local newspaper over logging in Berrytown, the fact that people now share their concerns is a big part of making us aware of the harm that can be done. So speak up if you see something that you don't think is harming the earth, or make someone know, make it known to someone who can do something about it. I don't know how many of you have heard of the Berrytown Forest Weed Warriors. That's a little group here in Berrytown, about 15 or so of us, town residents that have signed up to be in the town's forest, to be weed warriors. Of these, our church has two representatives, which you probably don't know, Dottie Ricks and myself. With the help from the Vermont Land Trust, the Berrytown Forest Weed Warriors are trying to say keep invasive species at bay. So we have invasive pool parties twice a year, spring and fall, for about 4 hours. It's not a huge amount of time, but every little bit helps. So our purpose is to pull the invasive plants around and in the borders of the town forest so that the invasive plants don't overrun or go into the forest area. This is, of course, a very small part of being good stewards of the earth. So, you know, there's about, in the U.S., the population between the ages of 18 and over is over 209 million people. That's a lot of people. So if we all could be aware of how we treat the earth, what we do as individuals to reverse generations of misuse of our homeland, think about what you buy, how you treat the land, what you can do to help get our planet healthy again. If everyone does even just a small part, we can make this planet healthy again. Let's all be good stewards of our homeland. Please join me in the call to worship. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place.
Who are we that you are mindful of us?
Creator of heaven and earth, thank you for creating us and loving us in a way that knows no limits.
We acknowledge you as Lord and praise you for all of creation.
Holy Spirit, we welcome you in this time of praise and worship.
Please, Lord, shape us and mold us into the disciples of Jesus Christ that you are calling us to be.
And Sylvia, I'm going to have Allison do the prelude, and then we'll do the first hymn.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No worries. That was just beautiful. Very peaceful. Thank you. Our first hymn today is going to be All Things Bright and Beautiful. If you're got the Glory of God hymnal, it's on page 20, and the Blue Presbyterian hymnal is 267. Amen. So I'll invite us now to our prayer of confession. And I'll invite us to just hold a moment of silence. And then at the end, we will hold another moment of silence for additional things for which we might ask for forgiveness. We offer this prayer of confession for those who are suffering from environmental injustice. Lord, hear our prayer. For those who do not have access to clean water, Lord hear our prayer. Thank you. For those who suffer health impacts from air pollution,
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the environmental racism that endangers and harms Black, Indigenous, and people of color,
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our oceans that are overwhelmed by plastic pollution,
Lord, hear our prayer.
For young people and future generations facing the fear of climate catastrophe,
Lord, hear our prayer.
And then we might in silence offer up other prayers of confession related to this earth which we are called to tend and keep. And Lord, we ask for not only forgiveness, but for strength that we might be the solution and not an ongoing part of the problem, caring for this fine earth. May all of God's people say, Amen.
The scripture lessons this morning are, there are three different ones. The first one is from Genesis 2, 4b through 9, and verse 15. This is the story of how it all started, of heaven and earth, when they were created, Adam and Eve. At the time God made earth and heaven, before any grasses or shrubs had sprouted from the ground, God hadn't yet sent rain on earth. Nor was there anyone around to work the ground. The whole earth was watered by underground springs. God formed man out of dirt from the ground and blew into his nostrils the breath of life. The man came alive, a living soul. Then God planted a garden in Eden, in the east. He put the man he had just made in it. God made all kinds of trees grow from the ground, trees beautiful to look at and good to eat. The tree of life was in the middle of the garden, also the tree of knowledge of good and evil. God took the man and set him down in the Garden of Eden to work the ground and keep it in order. The second scripture is from Romans 8, verse 19. That's why I don't know why there's any comparison between the present hard times and the coming good times. The created world itself can hardly wait for what's coming next. Everything in creation is being more or less held back. The third verse is, scripture lesson is Colossians 1, 17 through 28. We look at this sun and see the God who cannot be seen. We look at this sun and see God's original purpose in everything created. For everything, absolutely everything, above and below, visible and invisible, rank after rank after rank of angels, everything that started in him and finds its purpose in him. He was there before any of it came into existence and holds it all together right up to this moment. And when it comes to the church, he organizes and holds it together like a head does a body. He was supreme in the beginning and leading the resurrection parade. He is supreme in the end. From beginning to end, he's there, towering far above everything, everyone. So spacious is he, so expansive that everything of God finds its proper place in him without crowding. Not only that, but all of the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms, get properly fixed and fit together in vibrant harmonies, all because of his death, his blood that poured down from the cross. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. So let me start off by saying that much of today's sermon is a compilation of words from a couple of sources. One of those is Wendell Berry's essay, Christianity and the Survival of Creation, and then a talk that Jim Blackburn gave, and it's entitled Earth Church, a Vision of Full World Spirituality, and I can send you to either of these later on. But the topic of today's service and sermon are quite simply creation. And I know more meaningful than listening to me reflect on this would be to take the next 21 or 22 minutes and go outside and just sit there and soak in creation. So honestly, I won't be offended if you get up right now and if you go do that. Or maybe you choose to stick around and listen, be open and find some time later on to be in creation, which is our focus. What I share, I don't know more than you know, and probably don't practice it as well as you do. But as we think about creation, and I'll add one other word to that, care, creation care. This is our central imperative for us living on Earth. Like, this is it. To have Earth, to inhabit it, we must care for it, as Sylvia mentioned at the beginning. So if we go a little ways back in history, our earliest Judeo-Christian stories about creation, they started to be told some 4,000 or 5,000 years ago. They paint this picture of God taking dust and dirt and blowing the breath of life into it. And it becomes a life, a soul. It becomes Adam. And then Eve. This is a story containing truth. It's a myth. This biblical worldview of the beginnings. So in biblical mythology, it started like 6,000 years ago. But now, to the best of our current abilities, we understand scientifically that things began in this way. Like 14 billion years ago, an explosion occurred that set in place what became Earth. Some say it's this pinwheel of creativity circling around 100 billion galaxies and trillions of stars. Earth, one of hundreds of trillions of planets, where 4.5 billion years ago, the rawest forms of life appeared. And then 3 billion years ago, cells could transform sunlight through photosynthesis, leading to this carbon cycle, which makes life possible. 550 million years ago, flatworms took shape. 300 million years ago, insects. 200 million years ago, mammals. The first inklings of our ancestors, 2.5 million years ago. And then 250,000 years ago, Homo sapiens began to walk along the earth. This newfound teacher of mine, Jim Blackburn, puts it this way in a talk that he called Earth Church. We share our origins with all creatures. The earth is our genesis. Without earth, we cease to be. We don't exist without it. Quoting Rene Descartes, "I think, therefore I am," Blackburn makes a little modification. The earth is, therefore I am. We are partners in life. And I don't need to tell you, that we're not partnering all that well. Could Earth have done it? She probably would have filed for divorce at least a few decades ago. Yet we're bound together, Earth and her creatures. And part of that failure, we need to own as a church community. Wendell Berry writes this: the complicity of Christian priests, preachers, and missionaries in the cultural destruction and the economic exploitation of the first peoples is notorious. Throughout the 500 plus years since Columbus' first landfall on the Bahamas, the evangelist has walked beside the conqueror and the merchant, too often blandly assuming that the Christian's cause was the same as the conqueror's. And while it's slowly changing, Christian organizations remain largely indifferent to the rape and plunder of the world in its traditional cultures. It's hardly too much to say that the certified Christian seems just as likely as anyone else to join the military-industrial conspiracy to murder creation, Berry concludes. To murder creation. For it is what we're doing effectively, which isn't only killing ourselves, but is it killing God, the creator of it all? The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein, says the psalmist in Psalm 24. It's all, or we are all, God's handiwork. Or as some of our native siblings would say, it's all that great Spirit's work. And here we are, these caretakers along the journey. As we immerse ourselves in the same Christian tradition that has been so complicit, if not destructive, we will discover that God found the world and God made it to be good, made for God's pleasure. And God continues to love it and find it worthy despite its reduction and corruption by us. You know, people who quote John 3:16, which we listened to and explored a few weeks ago, if the people who quote it as an easy formula for getting into heaven neglect to see the great difficulty implied by the statement that the advent of Christ was made possible by God's love for the world. Not God's love for heaven, not God's love for the world as it might be, but God's love for the world as it was and as it is. Belief in Christ is thus made dependent upon prior belief in the inherent goodness and lovability of the world. The creation is not in any sense independent of the creator, the result of the primal creative act long over and done with, but it's a continuous, constant participation of all creatures in the being of God. Elihu said to Job, that if God gather unto himself his spirit and his breath, all flesh shall perish together. Psalm 104 says, thou sendest forth thy spirit, they are created. Creation is God's presence in creatures. So if we dishonor the creatures, aren't we dishonoring God? The Greek Orthodox theologian Philip Sherard has written that creation is nothing less than the manifestation of God's hidden being. To every creature, the gift of life is a portion of that breath and spirit of God. Or as the poet George Herbert puts it, thou art in small things great, not small in any. For thou art infinite in one and all. Our destruction of nature is not just bad stewardship or stupid economics or the betrayal of family responsibility. It is the most horrid of blasphemies. And this bad stewardship and this blasphemy results in what has become an untenable situation. We know it, don't we? due disproportionately to residents of this country. You probably know the statistics like Jim Blackburn does. We citizens of the United States are number one in consumption. We generate about 20 tons of carbon dioxide per person per year compared to the global average of about 5. We use more resources per capita than just about any civilization on Earth. If all those citizens of the world consumed like we do, we would need to have about 4 or 5 Earths to supply all of us at the same level that we are consuming today. Yet as far as we know, there's only one Earth around one sun in the galaxy that can support life. So our climate's changing and we are responsible. What's worse is that our sisters and brothers who are Black or Indigenous or people of color are disproportionately impacted, living in closer proximity to industrial sites, impacted more by our exploitation, downstream from pollution and toxins. Just ask our neighbors of Flint, Michigan, or Cancer Alley in the lower Mississippi River, those impacted by West Virginia or Alabama's coal ash. It's called environmental racism, which people work on seeking. We pray and act using environmental justice. You know, I talk with my children or with other young people who aren't only unsure of what their future will be like, but they're, I don't know if the best word is concerned or depressed. Like, would they even choose to have children now to bring them into this world? They're all asking that question. They're worried. They're angry that people aren't doing more, kicking the problem down the road that is their future. So here we are at this crisis point. Today, we need new pathways to navigate a new life, a deceptive landscape where ways of the past don't work anymore. The challenge is to evolve our thinking and our action now. Because as environmentalists tell us, there's this rapidly closing window. As people of faith, having been part of the problem, we must become part of the solution as well. For we've been charged, we believe, by God to tend and to keep the earth, which is the manifestation of God. So Jim Blackburn invites people to participate in what he calls Earth Church, which is about enjoying life and other living things. As a member of Earth Church, the earth is the foundation of one's existence and celebrated. A member of Earth Church would say, "Earth makes me smile, brings me joy, humility, and awe." They'd say, "It opens my heart and my kinship with every living thing and enhances my life." The Earth Church first came, Blackburn says, as a spiritual concept. The earth, members of the Earth Church would say, is spiritual base to me. It supports me in all my ways. I meet and absorb the earth. It can be in my yard. It can be out my window at work. It can be in the marsh. It can be floating down a river. It can be walking through a field. In Earth Church, I become connected with the rhythms of the earth, the cycles of the moon, and our journey around the sun with the seasons. My attendance in Earth Church is not limited to a particular time of day or a month. I simply find a natural place to allow it to invade my soul and enter my spirit. Earth Church has the spiritual core. If you become open to it, it will become manifest. My spirit is liberated, Blackburn says, by experiencing Earth Church, along with countless songs and sounds of nature, poems are the song of Earth Church. So Jim Blackburn has one poem called Rosetta Spoonbill. This is what they look like. I am in the church of the earth, and the pink bishop is in residence, striding across the flat yellow ground, head down, moving to and fro. I come to Earth Church for services that renew my soul. The sunrise starts the service by allowing me to see a gift for which I am grateful. I listen to the choirs of red-winged blackbirds greeting the sun, welcoming me. The pink bishops rise, painting the blue sky with a pink ribbon of undulating life, speaking to my very essence of the nature of life on this rare and precious planet, of the relationship between all living things, of our duty as stewards, of the responsibility that comes with being one of the living. The congregation gathers in celebration, the ibis, the willet, the standpipers, chirping praise to the glorious day that I celebrate by enjoying it, by living it to the fullest. The benediction is laid by the presence of the Ara, the Karakara, by a special keeper who comes to tell me that it is good that I've come to church today, asking me to take his message back to those with whom he does not speak, asking me to come again. I leave church with a smile, and I pray to the pink ones that I live to attend again. This is the Earth Church. This is what it's about. The songs of the birds, the hues of the living, dashing lizards and circling hawks. We can face the threat of a changing climate and many other modern day horrors when we make time to enjoy the earth, a kinship much larger than ourselves. So as a what I'll call 10 commandments of earth care for us as a people of God, I'll place before you Jim Blackburn's 10 principles of the Earth Church. They are these. Respect for life and other living things. We come from common stock and must embrace other living things. Population reduction through education and reproduction rights for women. Basic needs of all people of the world being met, food, water, and shelter. Identification and realization of enough. We reduce consumption and live this mantra, I use enough, I have enough. Human economic principles over time should conform to the Earth's principles. Unmitigated growth is a false god and is unsustainable on Earth. Equitable support for conditions that foster life on Earth. There is environmental justice. A mandate to celebrate and learn about your place, your geographic center on Earth. Cooperation as the highest form of social interaction. The adoption of creative conflict resolution concepts, and ultimately the elimination of warfare. And lastly, number 10 on the principles, an ability to accept change, an essential core aspect of the Earth Church. So this is Earth Church, as Jim Blackburn puts it out, a way of being that honors God's creation and a way of being that provides for the earth's and for our future. Just like those first people who were charged, tend, till, keep this world. It's our invitation now. It is our calling. Oh God, may you strengthen us to live into it, especially as residents and inhabitants of this country. Grant us strength, courage, and wisdom for the sake of our children and for your sake, of course, oh God. Amen. So it's one step down this road of becoming the Earth Church. I'll invite us to follow Neil and Allison's lead in singing for the beauty of the earth. So at this time, if people would like to unmute, you're welcome to unmute yourself. If you have prayers that you bring, they might be something you're completely excited about, something that's weighing heavy on your heart. Please feel free to share those with folks gathered. Are there any prayers people would like to mention? Roxanne?
Just a prayer of joy. I got the happy experience of going to a Zoom birthday for Margie Jones, who was a member of this church quite a few years back, and now lives in, I believe it's North Carolina, but it was kind of, she's a faithful person who I swear every time you have a birthday or Easter or any service, she's somebody who is always just so thoughtful and kind of generous. And she also said she has been watching the Facebook. So if she's out there, you know, a second, you know, we love you, Margie. And it was wonderful to be a part of her celebration. And prayers for this continuing joy of her life.
Amen. Thanks so much, Roxanne. Mm-hmm. What other prayers do people bring?
Carl?
Yes.
Carl, thanks. Yeah. Prayers of thanks for the, as our prayer of confession indicated, for all those who are working in behalf of the saving of the earth and the conserving of our environment. And prayers of thanks for everybody who, as always, participated in today's service. Sylvia's call to worship and her intro to the service was very appropriate and lovely. And Allison's music and Neil's voice, your prompting, all the things that enhanced the message, the general message of the morning, and how much we gain from it. And prayers that we continue to follow what has been made aware to what we've been made aware of.
Mm. May all God's people say amen. Thank you, Peg. Janet?
Prayers of thanks for the renewal of spring, and prayers for those injured in mass shootings this past week, and for the lawmakers who do nothing about it.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. What other prayers do people bring? Yes, George?
Prayers for Queen Elizabeth. She is now alone. She's by herself, and she has been a wonderful role model. It's a very, very sad time for her, and I felt very sad myself. So prayers for her and her family.
And those who hold her in our hearts, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. What other prayers do people bring? Any others? Okay. Then I'll invite us to join in prayer. I'll begin our prayer with a poem. It's called The Swan by Mary Oliver. Did you see it drifting all night on the Black River? Did you see it in the morning, rising in the silvery air, an arm full of white blossoms, a perfect commotion of silk and linen as it leaned into the bondage of its wings, a snowbank, a bank of lilies, biting the air with its black beak? Did you hear it, fluting and whistling, a shrill, dark music like the rain pelting the trees, like a waterfall knifing down on the black ledges? And did you see it finally just under the clouds, a white cross streaming across the sky, its feet like black leaves, its wings like the stretching light of the river? And did you feel it in your heart, how it pertained to everything? And have you too finally figured out what beauty is for? And have you changed your life? But we ask, O God, for the wisdom to know how to change our lives as we seek to follow your way of caring for creation, which is indeed a gift. It's not ours, but it's yours and belongs to all creatures who inhabit the earth. We pray, O God, for the prayers that were spoken and for prayers that remained unspoken. We pray for those who are experiencing new life and those who are nearing the ends of their life. And we ask, O God, that you would hold us and keep us and strengthen us as your people, who even now with boldness pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. not quite sure what to say. Amen. Thank you so much. So I feel like we should just be done now. Let's see, Janet, you have something you're going to share, and then Kathy Jamison, if you would, if you'd share for a few minutes, that would be great. Why don't we do it in that order?
Oh, okay. I would like to share with everyone that Presbyterian women are not having their in-person retreat on the weekend of May 8th. However, on May 8th, we are having an online retreat via Zoom, and it's going to be a really exciting program. It's from 9 until noon, and to be provided the link, just let me know that you would like to attend, and I will send you the link for that. And the presenters are going to be four wonderful pastors from our presbytery, Heather Prince Doss of Elliott in Massachusetts, Diane Hop Hugo and Tia Cornelius of Maine, and Deb McKinley from East Craftsbury. So we're going to be exploring drinking deeply from the well, sustenance for a journey as we pause to reflect in this pandemic year. And we're going to have different breakout groups. So you can choose which group you wish to, with whom you wish to participate. So we're going to be talking about times of silence, times of turning, and times of joy. And those are going to be the things that the pastors will be reflecting on. And then we'll have a short worship service at the end of our meeting. So please let me know if you are interested in joining us, and I will be happy to send you a link for the program. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Janet. Kathy.
Great, thanks, Carl. Carl asked me to spend a few minutes talking about earth care. And so first of all, I just want to let you know that even though I work for the state of Vermont, everything I'm about to say is I'm being said as an individual, as a member of this congregation. So thank you. And thanks to Sylvia, who I think set the table really well today by talking about, you know, the number of issues we have before us and that we should be considering of, and then Carl in his sermon as well. But today, what I'd like to do is kind of bring it down and focus it down, earth care, creation care is on the cusp. This week coming up is Earth Day. And so I just really want to bring it down to a couple of actions as individuals you can take to help with probably one of the most important environmental crises that we have, and that's with climate change. And so, Greta Thunberg is absolutely right that we are we have a very short window, and it's not just her saying this, but many people are saying we have a very short window to reduce the amount of carbon and carbon dioxide that is contributing to greenhouse gases. And it's so easy. And I know I feel overwhelmed sometimes when I think about the complexity and the magnitude of climate change. And it can, and when one's overwhelmed like that, you can feel like, oh gosh, there's nothing I can do to actually make any difference. That's not true. And so what I'd like to do is share with you a couple of things. And so, and they come from a book. I haven't read the whole book, but I've seen excerpts of it on the internet, and it's called Drawdown by Paul Hawkins. And he and some other folks looked at climate change and activities that are occurring, and they quantified which ones are actually contributing the most to climate change. And that's important so that way we can take action and get the biggest bang for the buck, as they say, or the low-hanging fruit, basically making the best impact with the first actions that we take, which is critical when our window is so short, right? And so in his book, Drawdown, he does list these activities. And in the top five activities that contribute to climate change, two relate to food. And since we as individuals deal with food on a daily basis, those are two activities we can think about and take action on and make positive impact toward trying to mitigate climate change. So the first one I'd like to share with you is on reducing food waste. Now, this is a figure I did not believe when I first heard it, but it is true that in America, and actually all like industrialized countries, are wasting 35 to 40% of the food that we grow. And that means we're not eating something that took a lot of resources to grow. So when food is wasted, we're wasting all the energy, resources, water, transportation that went into growing that food, and then we're just throwing it away. So you're basically throwing away all that energy and water and effort. And rather than throw it away, it would be far greater benefit to actually eat it, right? Another detrimental impact from wasting food when we throw it away is organic matter that goes to the landfill creates methane. Methane is 23 times worse to the environment than carbon dioxide. So it's far better to compost the food waste than to throw it into the trash, because composting creates carbon dioxide, which is not as potent as methane. But it's even better to eat edible food than it would be to compost it. So move it up the ladder, right? And the best reason, well, not from an environmental, but maybe from a motivational reason, the best reason not to waste food is it saves you money. And who doesn't want to save money, right? So there's lots of reasons why not to waste food. And, you know, when I started thinking about it, I found, you know, when you start separating out your food from your trash, which you're supposed to do now, by the way, you realize how much you're wasting. And there are tips that can be used to try to minimize how much we waste, like dedicating a space to your fridge to the most perishable food, the thing that's probably not going to last much more than another day or two. And that way you can focus on that. And I love using that tip because it makes me, it takes a little bit ease out of my meal prep, because I know, okay, I know what I'm eating for supper tonight because it's on that shelf. And I don't have to kind of think and worry about supper. So, so being more mindful about the food that we waste is one way you can try to reduce your impact on climate change. The other aspect is eating less red meat, or eating less meat altogether, but particularly red meat, because cows generate methane, right? And methane, again, is that potent greenhouse gas. And so if we can reduce methane generation and eat foods that are less meat-based, especially less red meat-based, we will have less impact to these greenhouse gases. Another personal benefit, just like saving money when you reduce food waste, is when you eat less red meat, you're basically giving yourself a benefit by having a healthier diet, you know, especially heart-healthy diet. So while these ideas might seem a little, you know, extreme, they really are not. They are becoming more and more mainstream. And so as evidence of that, I was thinking about that this week. I shop at Hannaford's, and I'm not plugging Hannaford's, but they have this flyer that they have periodically. And in their flyer, they have a sheet is like, why does Hannaford fight food waste? And so they're on board with fighting food waste, not only because it's the law, but because there are so many environmental benefits. And then they're also on board with promoting, even though they sell meat, I mean, they have a huge meat section, right? But they are promoting plant-based diets by having recipes on how you can, you know, have heart-healthy meals that don't involve me. And so these are becoming more mainstream, and these ideas help us become better stewards of the environment. And so there are lots of other actions people can take. If you are concerned about climate change, you can Google it. You can see what the top actions people can take, focus on transportation, refrigerants, construction, alternative energy, all kinds of things you can take. But if you want to start today, you can do that by looking at how you manage your food. So those are my suggestions, kind of trying to take positive action in this world where we sometimes might feel a little overwhelmed with what's happening. Thank you, Carl, for allowing me to share.
Hey, Kathy, thanks for bringing your knowledge and your inspiration to us. So I'll invite us now to sing our last hymn along with Neil and Allison, God of the Sparrow. Now may we go from this place to love God and to tend to the earth which God has given us. May we be stewards and may we be faithful in our following. Amen. Thank you.